So, here we are, and we're going to have a look at Thomas Middleton's Women, Beware Women. And I think you probably know more about this period of English in the repertoire than I do, because you've been doing a lot of it recently with The Dutch Courtesan, which was a lovely production, which I saw. And this play, I thought we'd start by just discussing the women in this play, first of all, because these scenes are particular to these two women. And Livia and Hippolyto are, of course, as we know, different ages. Livia is an older woman, isn't she? Would you say?
39.
And 39 then would be more like 59 now. And she's a widow. So, and she's been a widow, I think she's been married a couple of times, I think we learn in the play. And so, and she's quite wealthy. So she's independent, which means that she has the ability to behave in an independent way, which was very, very, gave her an enormous liberation at that time, because she was able to move in society without having to be, without having to have a man with her for a start. And she had money which she could, she had. It's exactly the same now that when Virginia Woolf talks about a room of one's own. If you're independent financially, it gives one enormous power, really, especially at that time. And Hippolyto is not, is her brother, and he doesn't have the same problems because he's a boy, a man. And then poor Isabella is a young woman, and she's been her father for reasons other than any true love or affection, want you to marry this ward, who is a stupid idiot, really. And that is the fun and also the tragedy of her life. And this would happen to a lot of girls, wouldn't it, at that time? They'd be forced into marriages, forced to breed children, and they were completely without any, they had no power in the house at all. I mean, at this time, husbands could beat their wives with no one would say, you know, that's a terrible thing to do. It was perfectly normal. So so she had very little, she has no status at all, whereas Livia has enormous status. And also she is allowed to do things because of what where she is in her life, an older woman. And she sort of can do anything she likes. And she sort of becomes, I think she's aware of it from the beginning, but when she's asked to do this particular thing that we're going to discuss in this scene, it's a little while beyond the realm of what she's been asked before. It's quite... I think also we must now discuss the relationship with Hippolyto that Livia has. And we learn in this scene that the relationship between the brother and sister, certainly from Livia's point of view, is one of deep affection, if not love. And love not entirely in a brother-sisterly way, is what I get out of it. And certainly when I played it, that is what I felt with Hippolyto. She is really in love with him. Whether they have the same parents, we don't know. Because in those days, people died in childbirth. So you might be the son of a stepmother of hers. We don't know, but we don't know any of this. We're just surmising. And I don't want to make it any more sort of less, what you might call, acceptable than it is, because we don't have any of this. But we can read in, if we were playing these parts in the theatre, we would have to create a back world for ourselves, and we can decide, you could decide, not me, but you could decide amongst yourselves, if you were doing this, what your relationships with each other are. So, but this is your niece, this is your niece,
yes,
isn't it? And this is...
Sister.
This is your sister, and this is your niece, sorry. Your sisters, and this is your niece.
Yes.
So, and she's and so consequently, you wouldn't have normally feelings other than uncle-y feelings towards your niece. And this is definitely not the case in from your point of view. And probably not. She's very fond of you. And you've been away, haven't you?
Yes.
It seems. And you've come back. So you've been away travelling. So, and then you've met this girl again when she's grown up, perhaps.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm making all this up, but this is what you can glean from the play when you read the earlier part of it. And if you're going to do this, if you're going to play these parts, this is what you have to do. It's all there in the text, not in this scene, but in the play. From the very first opening of the play, there is a story going on, of course, and you have to glean what you can to get the relationships in the family and where they are status-wise in the society in which they live. And I would reckon that these are quite high status people. I would say that they were very well married, and they're certainly not sort of merchant class. They're above that. They're not even professional. I think they're sort of, you know, minor aristocracy in a way, in sort of where they live. And I was still talking last night with Mike about Thomas Middleton as a writer, and saying that I think, contrary to, different from Shakespeare, who is a much more lyrical writer, and his language is much more poetic, Thomas Middleton seems to me to be a much more of the street. He's much more sort of, I think it's the difference between, say, because he writes in a form as well, if nowadays we were to say T.S. Eliot and Harold Pinter, say. And I'd say that the voice of Harold Pinter is very urban, whereas T.S. Eliot isn't. He's much more lyrical. But they're both poets in their way, and they're both extremely gifted wordsmiths. So I think on those levels, that is the difference between them. There's one who's very much of the... And this language, I would be interested, perhaps we could have a little read of the of perhaps the first scene, which would be between Livia and Hippolyto. And then we will read, and then up to when the servant comes in. And then we'll just have a look at that first bit. Okay, let's just set the scene here a bit, because we can get up and move it about a little bit when we've just looked at this. Mm-hmm. But I think there's an empty stage, seemingly, and enter Livia in Hippolyto. So it seems to me that at the beginning of this, let's start, and then I will hear what you have, how you read it, and then we'll have a little listen after. We'll have a little talk about it afterwards.
Okay. A strange affection, brother. When I think on it, I wonder how thou camest by it.
E'en as easily as a man comes by destruction, which oft times he wears in his own bosom.
Is the world so populous in women, and creation so prodigal in beauty, and so various? Yet does love turn thy point to thy own blood? 'Tis somewhat too unkindly. Must thy eye dwell evilly on the fairness of thy kindred, and seek not where it should? It is confined now in a narrower prison than was made for it. It is allowed a stranger. And where bounty is made the great man's honour, 'tis ill husbandry to spare, and servants shall have small thanks for it. So he heaven's bounty seems to scorn and mock, that spares free means and spends of his own stock.
Never was man's misery so soon summed up, counting how truly.
Nay, I love you so, that I shall venture much to keep a change from you, so fearful as this grief will bring upon you. Faith, it even kills me when I see you faint under a reprehension, and I'll leave it, though I know nothing can be better for you. Prithee, sweet brother, let not passion waste the goodness of thy time and of thy fortune. Thou keep'st the treasure of that life I love as dearly as mine own. And if you think my former words too bitter, which were ministered by truth and zeal, 'tis but a hazarding of grace and virtue, and I can bring forth as pleasant fruits as sensuality wishes in all her teeming longings. This I can do.
Oh, nothing that can make my wishes perfect.
I would that love of yours were pawned to it, brother. and as soon lost that way as I could win. Sir, I could give as shrewd a lift to chastity as any she that wears a tongue in Florence. She'd need be a good horsewoman and sit fast, whom mine strong argument could not fling at last. Prithee, take courage, man. Though I should counsel another to despair, yet I am pitiful to thy afflictions, and will venture hard, I will not name for what, 'tis not handsome, find you the proof and praise me.
Well, then I fear me I shall not praise you in haste.
This is the comfort. You are not the first, brother, has attempted things more forbidden than this seems to be. I'll minister all cordials to you now, because I cheer you up, sir.
I'm past hope.
Love, thou shalt see me do a strange cure, then, as e'er was wrought on a disease so mortal and near akin to shame. When shall you see her?
Never in comfort more.
You're so impatient, too.
Will you believe? Death, she's forsworn my company and sealed it with a blush.
So I perceive all lies upon my hands, then. Well, the more glory when the work's finished. How now, sir, the news?
Very good. Well, that was made absolute sense and was very well read. Now, I think we're going to lift the ante a bit here and make it much more dangerous. We'll make it dangerous by making it secretive for a start. And also, he has confessed a love that's not natural. No. So all these things make it a much more dangerous thing for you to receive.
Okay.
And to hear about, and also to be shocked by. Also, okay. There's a number of feelings there, so that when you hear this, it's a strange affection, brother.
Mm.
And it's not the normal, this is not the normal. And you go on in the next speech to say, why, you know, you've got all the women in the world you could choose from, why are you choosing this narrow path, and you're one of your own? Mm. I mean, come on, you know, you've got to, this is very dangerous. You mustn't do this, is what she's saying. And then, so I think we'll just do this first page and see how we get on with actually giving, and I think there's also, they've chosen, you must remember that in these places, there were servants everywhere. Everywhere there were servants. There were servants behind doors, there were servants upstairs. The people did not live in private as we do now. Life was a much more public thing. So you must give it a sort of urgency, because you've caught a moment where you can speak. And I don't mean that you have to whisper so you can't be heard, but there's a sort of urgency behind what you say. And if you can just follow that, if you see that the way that it's, I don't know who did this, but if it was Middleton who did it, certainly very helpful one here. The broken line here means that you come in very quickly on each one of them. So it's, a strange affection, brother, when I think of it. I wonder how that came about. In as easily. So it gives a sort of, so you're really having a conversation. There's nothing on the back foot about this. You're here, and you want to hear one's information. And you also want to say to him, my goodness me, are you sure about this? And why? You've got the world here.
Mm.
You're a good-looking man and all the rest of it. Why are you choosing to love in your own backyard? This is very dangerous. I mean, you could get, you know, sent to prison for this sort of affection. You must be careful. But also, how did it come about? So there's all, and also, because you're Olivia, and because you're the sort of person you are, because you read the rest of the play, you know, it also is quite the erotically rather interesting, all this.
Yes.
I mean, that he should like, you know, there's a whole lot, it's not very nice, but you know, it's sort of, it's quite exact. You know, this woman is not, she's a wonderful person, but she's so terrible.
Mm.
But and she has so many sort of thoughts. She's a complicated person, and she's lived a life, and she's been around, and she's, you know,
yes.
Not everything has been. I always feel with Olivia, not everything has been entirely above board.
Mm.
You know, so it gives her a sort of feeling. So I think that. So let's have a little go at this first scene. Inject. I don't expect you to do everything at once, of course not. But these are just the feelings you get, because then
yes.
It gives it an urgency, and you're telling a story. And also it means that you're in front of the audience, because the audience will have to catch up with you, and never explain anything to an audience. If you say it as clearly as you said it then, you're not giving them a lesson in how we speak, or do you understand that before you go on. They will get the mood, and they will get the language, because of the intention behind what you're saying. So let's have another go, and let's start quite as if they've come into the room and they've just, the door is shut behind them, and then they start. So it's like, well, they've got a moment. So let's see how we get on. So, into the room, shut the door, and...
A strange affection, brother. When I think on it, I wonder how thou camest by it.
In as easily as a man comes by destruction, which oft times he wears in his own bosom.
Is the world so populous in women, and creation so prodigal in beauty, and so various, yet does love turn thy point to thy own blood? 'Tis somewhat too unkindly. Must thy eye dwell evilly on the fairness of thy kindred, and seek not where it should? It is confined now in a narrower prison than was made for it. It has allowed a stranger. And where bounty is made the great man's honour, 'tis ill husbandry to spare, and servants shall have small thanks for it. So he heaven's bounty seems to scorn and mock, that spares free means and spends of his own stock.
Never was man's misery so soon summed up, counting how true...
Nay, I love you so.
That's lovely. Now, I think you see how immediately it's more interesting, because you're saying that. But also, I think there's you could also add an area on top of that of it has thrown your composure, so you don't have the composure that you would normally have. It's really put the heebie-jeebies up you.
Okay.
And so you're not telling him anything, you're not telling him off, you're just saying, how could you do it?
Okay.
You're not saying, like a teacher, well, why could you look, why didn't you? It's, you know, you're amazed by it.
Okay.
When you know, how have you got this? Mm-hmm. You see, because then if we start there, by the time we get to the end, you've turned right round, which is a much more interesting journey.
Yes.
So let's just do that again and just add that another little ingredient of actually, you're on a par with him. I mean, it's like two people who get behind a shed and smoke cigarettes when they shouldn't, and they, and you're not an older sister, you're just the two of them, and you're sharing this really frightful, at the moment, dangerous thing. So let's just do that once more.
A strange affection, brother. When I think on it, I wonder how thou camest by it.
Even as easily as a man comes by destruction, which oft times he wears in his own bosom.
Is the world so populous in women, and creation so prodigal in beauty, and so various, yet does love turn thy point to thy own blood?
I think that's lovely. What I think is it's even more. I mean, this is news. I can't believe you're telling me this. A strange affection, brother. You know. When I think on it, how camest thou by it? And then he says that. Is the world so populous with women that for goodness sake, don't do this. Mm-hmm. It's much more sort of, you can't do it all at once. I know. You're so prodigal and beautiful, so various. It does love turn the point on thine own blood. I mean, for goodness sake. You see, it's got much more danger about it.
The danger.
Because if you're dangerous, then the audience know that this is not allowed.
Mm-hmm.
So it requires that sort of anguish. Because you're worried for him. You don't want him to get into trouble. And he will. So the stakes are very high at this moment.
Rather than just telling him off.
No, it's not telling off. This is not telling off. It's pointing, it's thinking, none of this is telling off.
Mm.
This is telling yourself what he is doing. So it's the meaning of this speech is nothing to do, it's as if she's thinking it out herself to him.
Mm-hmm.
It's like she's thinking it for the first time. It's thinking it like first time. So is the world, I mean, she's thinking to herself, is the world so populous with women? I mean, that, and creation, so prodigal in beauty and so various, yet does love turn thy point on thine own blood? I mean, for goodness sake. You know, it's a sort of, so it has a sort of energy about it.
Yes.
So let's just try it again. We won't get it all, but this is the feeling.
Yes, okay. Yeah. A strange affection, brother. When I think on on it, I wonder how thou camest by it.
It's
much better. You see, that's the feeling. Because it's oh, my goodness. And actually, I think you could be more... I think you have to hide it. And it's more shocking.
Right, just okay.
Remember, it's terribly shocking what he's telling you. Mm-hmm. And also quite exciting.
Okay.
So,
all of these things. It's so hard.
But once you get it, it's fine. And you can't be getting it now. I mean, you'd have 5 weeks rehearsal. So don't worry. We've got an hour. So I don't expect it. But it's just these are the ideas I'm throwing out a bit.
Okay. A strange affection, brother. When I think on it, I wonder how thou camest by it.
Well, even as easily as a man comes by destruction, which oft times he wears in his own bosom.
Is the world so populous in women, and creation so prodigal in beauty and so various, yet does love turn thy point to thy own blood? Tis somewhat too unkindly. Must thy eye dwell evilly on the fairness of thy kindred, and seek not where it should? It is confined now in a narrower prison than was made for it. It is allowed a stranger. Where bounty is made the great man's honour, 'tis ill husbandry to spare, and servants shall have small thanks for it. So he, heaven's bounty, seems to scorn and mock that spares free means and spends of his own stock.
Never was man's misery so soon summed up.
That's lovely. I think the last little first, the last three, that was exactly what I meant. And you can go much further when you know it. But the last three, so I think that she gets quite cross here on the last two lines.
Yeah.
So heaven, I mean, for goodness sake, so heaven's bounty seems to spend, and spends his own, so heaven's bounty seems to scorn and mock the spares free means. I mean, you know, they're all for free there, and spends on his own stock. I mean, for goodness sake, she suddenly gets angry too.
Mm.
So there's a whole lot of emotions. There's fear, there's, what the hell have you done? Aren't there masses of women in the world that you could go after? Why do you have to choose this very narrow lane? And then, for goodness sake, pull yourself together. So there's all that going on. Do you see?
Yes.
So we'll go on now, because otherwise we'll never get to you, poor thing. And that was very nicely said, because I know it's not a great deal, but what you said had the right feeling, because it seemed to me to be slightly embarrassed, but you've obviously held it in your heart a long time, this, and you've had a scene when Hippolyto, and when Isabella has rejected you, or seemed very cross, because you've obviously made some sort of move towards her, and this has not been accepted. So, you know, you're really, I mean, you've got this passion for her. You really sort of, you've got the hots. So you've got to sort of manage it, and you've got to tell someone. Somebody has to know. And this is who you've told. So let's go on. And then now you see, this is the thing about Livia. She changes so quickly after he says. So if we go from Hippolyto's speech, never is man... You see, this is the thing, that he's at the end of his tether. He's absolutely at the end of his tether with this line and a half. So... That's what he's, because he doesn't know what to do.
Yeah.
And then she says, nay, I love you so. So, you see, it catches, she adores him. Mm. So she'll make it work. Okay. So we don't know that yet, but she's going to try and do something.
Never was man's misery so soon summed up. Counting how true...
Nay, I love you so, that I shall venture much to keep a change from you, so fearful as this grief will bring upon you. Faith, it even kills me when I see you fainter under a reprehension, and I'll leave it, though I know nothing can be better for you. Prithee, sweet brother, let not passion waste the goodness of thy time and of thy fortune. Thou keep'st the treasure of that life I love as dearly as mine own, and if you think my former words too bitter, which were ministered by truth and zeal... 'Tis but a hazarding of grace and virtue, and I can bring forth as pleasant fruits as sensuality wishes in all her teeming longings. This I can do.
Oh, nothing that can make my wishes perfect.
I would that love of yours were pawned to it, brother, and as soon lost as that way I could win. Sir, I could give as shrewd a lift to chastity as any she that wears a tongue in Florence. She'd need be a good horsewoman and sit fast, whom mine strong argument could not fling at last. Prithee, take courage, man. Though I should counsel another to despair, yet I am pitiful to thy afflictions, and will venture hard. I will not name for what, 'tis not handsome. Find you the proof, and praise me.
Then I fear me I shall not praise you in haste.
This is the comfort. You are not the first, brother, has attempted things more forbidden than this seems to be. I'll minister all cordials to you now, because I'd cheer you up, sir.
I am past hope.
Love, thou shalt see me do a strange cure then, as e'er was wrought on a disease so mortal and near akin to shame. When shall you see her?
Never in comfort more.
You're so impatient, too.
Will you believe? Death, she's forsworn my company and sealed it with a blush.
So I perceive all lies upon my hands then. Well, the more glory when the work's finished.
Lovely. Now, this woman at the beginning in this first speech was a different woman to the one that I heard just then, because there's nothing, she's a very dangerous woman, Olivia. So you have to forget any feeling of ease with, you're going to step, when you play this part, you have to step completely out of anything that you, as a nice, well brought up girl, has. You have to be quite the contrary to that. Think Lady Gaga and all those people. This is the sort of person, not that she's anything like that, but the thing is, she leads another sort of way of life. She's not in this comfort area of York and a nice middle class town. She lives on the street, she has the wits, and she's very quick, and she's very, very sharp, and she also can deliver. So she's very scheming. And she's also, and this is the thing that you will get all these things, she's very sophisticated. Yeah. She's been around. I mean, she really has. So I think that this next speech that we have here, she's thinking it out as she goes, and she also cannot bear him to be in any sort of suffering. So this first bit is really felt. She says, I say, up until the first four lines, one, two, one, two, change in thee, so fearful of this grief will bring upon you. You see, he's suicidal. Mm-hmm. The thing about theatre and about drama is that everything is raised, especially in this play and plays like this. The whole temperature is raised. If we do it just sort of as we're doing, you know, you're a bit sad, sorry about that, because you know you love your sister. You know, it's not very interesting. Yes. If it's, you're suicidal because you're going to lose yourself. Suddenly everyone sits up and goes, oh my God, you see. So it's everything is, think of it as being Italian or French or something, because it's not us all sitting here and being nice. There's nothing nice about these people. That's what's so fun playing them. That's what's so fun being an actor, because you can be ghastly, and it gets rid of all those feelings you have. So this is what I think you have to remember. Mm. So fearful of this grief, and everything is very passionate. So yes. What she feels for him is very passionate. How she's going to change it is very passionate. She's a yes. very passionate, scheming, sophisticated, hard, after the main chance, greedy woman. All those things apply to Olivia. And so all those things have to be, that will come into play when she does this. So let's just do it again. Okay. Bringing all those things in. I don't expect it. But those are the feelings. Mm-hmm. Because she's sort of, she's complicated. Mm. And there's nothing easy about her. And it's very difficult because we don't know each other, and you know, we're all sitting in chairs in this nice room. But there's a sort of danger about her, and so let's just try it again. And we'll, if I stop you, please don't get cross.
Because please do.
I know, no, but you know, when people keep interrupting you, it's so annoying. But I will try, and if I see it, I'll just point the little thing out. So let's go from Hippolyta at the bottom of the page there.
Never was man's misery so soon summed up, counting how truly.
Nay, I love you so, that I shall venture much to keep a change from you, so fearful as this grief will bring upon you. Faith, it even kills me when I see you faint under a reprehension, and I'll leave it, though I know nothing can be better for you. Prithee, sweet brother, let not passion waste the goodness of thy time and of thy fortune. Thou keeps the treasure of that life I love as dearly as mine own.
Those are true words. Mm. Thou keepst, yes, thou keepst the treasure of that life I love as dearly as my own. I love you as much as I mean, as much as I wouldn't want to kill myself. I love you the same as I feel about my life. You know, I love you more. You're so important to me. So that is what that line has to feel. And so then we see why she goes to the things. Mm. She's showing enormous love for him, because it's a love that can't speak its name either,
yes,
what she has. Mm. Because later on she nearly kills him when she thinks that he's killed her, you know. Mm. So now let's do it. So let's just do so fearful.
Mm-hmm. So fearful as this grief will bring upon you. Faith, it even kills me when I see you faint under a reprehension, and I'll leave it, though I know nothing can be better for you. Prithee, sweet brother, let not passion waste the goodness.
Let not what?
Let not passion waste.
Yes, let not passion.
Prithee, sweet brother, let not passion waste the goodness of thy time.
I don't think it's just louder. I think it's just, okay. It's what you feel when you're in ecstasy. Let not passion. It's passion. Mm. Passion is something, you know, the word passion, we have a passion for something. It's something we really love. So it's not a word that we just use, I'm full of passion. You see, I'm full of passion.
Yes.
So it's sort of, it has a feeling.
Yes.
So I don't want you to overdo it. I just want you to, just to remark on the word. I don't mean by that you have to overemphasize it. It's just that when you say it, which of course is difficult because we don't know it, but just these words, that is a wonderful word, passion.
Mm-hmm.
And so it just needs a feeling. So let's do, just do that from Faith, it even kills me.
Faith, it even kills me when I see you faint under a reprehension, and I'll leave it, though I know nothing can be better for you. Prithee, sweet brother, let not passion waste the goodness of thy time and of thy fortune. Thou keeps the treasure of that life I love as dearly as mine own. And if you think my former words too bitter, which were ministered by truth and zeal, 'tis but a hazarding of grace and virtue, and I can bring forth as pleasant fruits as sensuality wishes in all her teeming longings. This I can do.
Yes, but you see, it's not that you become again somebody who is in charge of herself. She's completely out of her. She's not in charge of herself. She's in a passion herself here. So it's not that it's thou keeps the treasure of that life I love as dearly as mine own. And if you think my former words too bitter, and she hasn't really been bitter. All she's pointed out is her shock at what, you know. She says, which were ministered by truth and zeal, which she's explained, 'tis but a hazarding of grace and virtue. Mm. Now, and I can bring forth, then, because she adores him, she says, then I can bring forth. She tempts him.
Mm.
She tempts him with these words, because she wants to do anything to please him.
Yeah.
So I can bring forth, and those words, I mean, all their teeming longings.
Yeah.
I mean, every sort of idea of how you love somebody, all those teeming longings,
mm-hmm.
I can produce for you.
Yes.
So it's very sensual, all this. It's very, very sensual writing.
Mm-hmm.
So so we might just go from, if you think my former words mm-hmm. too bitter.
If you think my former words too bitter, which were ministered by truth and zeal, 'tis but a hazarding of grace and virtue. And I can bring forth as pleasant fruits as sensuality wishes in all her teeming longings. This I can do.
Oh, now, no. If you said that with a great big smile on your face, just try it.
Okay.
Just try saying that.
I can.
Let's just try I can bring forth, yes.
I can bring forth as pleasant fruits as sensuality wishes in all her teeming longings. Yes. This I can do.
Yes, but also, this is your lover. Mm-hmm. So you want to seduce him with it. So okay. If you can do that, smile, and this is
seduce,
your lover.
Smile, trying to...
Very hard.
I can bring forth as pleasant fruits as sensuality wishes in all her teeming longings. This I can do.
You see, suddenly, it's much more interesting because you're seducing him as well by what you can do. Because you can't go out and say, you know, I want to go to bed with you. But you can do things for him.
Yes, make him
you happy. Can make him. You can actually look on in a rather sort of, you know, you can look on to him making love to you, someone else, which will give you some sort of sacrifice. It's terrible. You know, it's very, very corrupt, this play. I mean, in our sort of sensibility. Mm. In those days, it was probably, you know, that's why the audience went. I mean, it was very racy. So they would look on to, you know, she would get her kicks by looking on to him making love to another woman.
Yes.
So that's what this is all about.
Mm.
So I hope we can continue. Okay, so let's continue on.
Oh, nothing that can make my wishes perfect.
I would that love of yours were pawned to it, brother.
I think that the thing is you're still in denial.
Yeah.
So I think you can say, oh, nothing that can make my wishes perfect. You can't do anything.
Right.
Where do you think you are? So then she has something to fight against.
Okay.
Because if you acquiesce with her,
yeah,
she wouldn't have to say the next speech.
Right.
But if you can still say, oh, nothing that could make my wishes perfect. I mean, my wish is perfect.
Yeah.
Don't hit the mic. Just say it. My wish is perfect. Because then she can say the next thing, because she's got to add to what she said before.
Yeah.
So if you... Do you see?
It gives it an impetus.
That's, yeah. So in all her teeming love, just say this I can do, and then she can...
This I can do.
Oh, nothing that can make my wishes perfect.
I would that love of yours were pawned to it, brother, and as soon lost as that way I could win. Sir, I could give as shrewd a lift to chastity.
Now, this little phrase here is showing off.
Yes.
She's showing off here. She's saying, I could give a lift to chastity. I could show you what. I can make someone stay, you know, chaste. They'd have to sit on a... I can give a lift to chastity. As any that wears... any she that wears a tongue in Florence. And then you go on to the horse. I could, you know, it'd have to be pretty good to stay on the horse that I did. Because I could get anyone to drop that. So she's sort of jaunty here.
Okay.
So show off
jaunty.
A bit. Yes. She shows off a bit there. So... Should we just do it from where you said?
Yeah. This I can do.
Oh, nothing that can make my wishes perfect.
I would that love of yours were pawned to it, brother, and as soon lost as that way I could win. Sir, I could give a shrewder lift to chastity as any she that wears a tongue in Florence. She'd need be a good horsewoman and sit fast, whom my strong argument could not fling at last. Prithee, take courage, man. Though I should counsel another to despair, yet I am pitiful to thy afflictions, and will venture hard. I will not name for what, 'tis not handsome. Find you the proof, and praise me.
Well, then I fear me I shall not praise you in haste.
Now, that's very good. I think that she could show off more. We won't go back on it. But she could show off more. That is what she's saying. She's saying... I could get anyone to drop their chastity for you. I could, and they'd have to be pretty strong to stay on the horse before I threw them off. She's sort of doing, you know, there's a certain sort of show-off about her here. That's what she's doing.
Okay.
And she wants to give him courage, and she also wants to show her credentials, her cards, which come into the... She wants to show her cards. She says, you think I can't do it? I can do anything you want. It's taking on the bet.
Yes.
You see, there's a lot of sort of, which is all to do, because there's a chess game later on and so on.
Playing.
There's a great deal of sort of playing that sort of thing. So we won't go back, but that was it. Oh, we must certainly not go. We must carry on. It's half past 11. Okay. Let's go on. to where we dropped, where we finished before.
Then I fear me, I shall not praise you in haste.
This is the comfort. You are not the first,
no,
brother.
This is, it's the comfort. So it must be the comfort. This is the comfort.
Okay.
And then you go on to say, you're not the first. Perhaps you're not the first to do this. You know, things can happen.
Mm-hmm.
Leave it to me. So,
okay. This is the comfort. You are not the first, brother, has attempted things more forbidden than this seems to be.
Don't think that you need hit the this. Things
okay.
more forbidden than this seems to be. I'll minister all cordials.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think, you don't have to, if you pick out those words, the other, the more important words don't ring. So just let it flow through.
This is the comfort. You are not the first, brother, has attempted things more forbidden than this seems to be. I'll minister.
And this seems to be.
This seems
take
to
the
be.
Line. Take the line to the end. Because if you say seems to be, then it's not interesting.
Mm.
But if it says this seems to be, give the line its flow through.
You are not the first, brother, has attempted things more forbidden than this seems to be. I'll minister all cordials to you now, because I'd cheer you up, sir.
I am past hope.
Love, thou shalt see me do a strange cure then, as e'er was wrought on a disease so mortal and near akin to shame. When shall you see her?
Never in comfort more.
You're so impatient, too.
Will you believe? Death, she's forsworn my company and sealed it with a blush.
So I perceive all lies upon my hands, then. Well, the more glory when the work's finished.
That's very good. Well, I thought that... Did you get a feel of the person you're dealing with?
Yes.
And what he's dealing with? It's all very much more dangerous. which is what we want to get. Much more dangerous, because this little innocent is coming into your... You're like this big spider. And this little innocent is coming in, and you're sitting there looking so nice. And stand like that, and jump. And it's going to give her a terrible fright. Or, well, you know, something is going to happen. But that is what you are.
Mm-hmm.
If you think of a spider, it's quite a good idea, actually. Because that's what they are. You have your fingers in everything. And you can move very fast, quickly, and you can sit and watch. I mean, actually, I would look at spiders if I was playing Livia.
Mm.
I think it's rather a good idea. You can sit there, and you've got all this round, you're completely benign, and suddenly you can go out there and give it what's right. So I think that's what Livia is about, myself. So let's move on, because then this poor little girl is going to come in and be given not know what's hit her. So... Carry on, please.
Do we have a servant? Is that
good?
How now, sir, the news?
Madam, your niece, the virtuous Isabella, is delighted to see you.
That's great fortune. Sir, your stars bless. You, simple, lead her in.
What's this to me?
Your absence, gentle brother. I must stir my wits for you.
Aye, to great purpose.
Beshrew you, but I loved you not so well. I'll go to bed and leave this deed undone. I am the fondest where I once affect, the carefulest of their healths and of their ease, forsooth, that I look still but slenderly to mine own. I take a course to pity him so much now that I have none left for modesty and myself. This 'tis to grow so liberal. You few sisters that love their brother's ease above their own honesties, but if you question my affections, that will be found my fault.
So what we're saying there, this is a moment when she has alone, really.
Mm.
And she's saying, God, I love you so much, I'd do anything for you. So there's nothing, there's no logic to what she's, to her feelings. She's out of, there's nothing settled about Livia.
Mm-hmm.
She'll do anything for him. So it's quite revealing about her.
Yes.
It's a true relationship, she loves him. So I think, beshrew you, would I love you not so well? It makes her sad. Because I'll go to bed and leave this deed undone. And then she knows herself, I'm the fondest where I most affect. I love him. I can't do anything about it. The carefulest of their healths, and of their ease forsooth, that I look still but slenderly on mine. I'm risking a lot for him. That's what you're saying there. So I take a course to pity him so much now that I have left all left for mod. I have none left for modesty in myself. And you know, that's what she's saying. This tis to grow so liberal. I mean, honestly, this is to start, you know, this is it. She's realistic. She knows what she's doing. So this is to grow so liberal. You few sisters that love their brother's ease above their honesties. I mean, she's going to tell a pack of lies.
Yes.
So she wants to say that. But if you question my affections, that will be found my fault. If you question them, this is my little, this is my indulgence. This is the thing I love most. So there's all those feelings going on. And there's nothing tidy about it. Because there's nothing tidy about true love. Emotions go everywhere. We muck up and we love too much, or we hate too much, or we get upset too much. And all these things, they're all very, very on the surface. Mm-hmm. Very, very on the surface at this moment in her life. And she's talking a lot of truth, an enormous amount of truth about herself. I won't go back on it because we must allow Isabella. So I think if I was staging this, because there's different ways of doing things, but I would, because you know that she's coming, I would have the door. You'd be standing here, and the door would go behind you, and without even turning round, because you know that tells the audience something. You'd say, niece, your love's welcome, and then turn around. It's like you know she's going to be there.
Yes.
And it makes her feel, you know, very at ease. Nothing's been going on in this room. You know, it's absolutely fine. Here I am. Niece, your love's welcome. Very easygoing. Nothing's been going on. Here you are. Isn't it lovely? No mention of him. Nothing's happened. And she comes in. And she's come for a bit of help, too. You don't know that. Well, we don't know yet. But let's carry on and see. Okay.
Niece, your love's welcome. Alas, what draws that paleness to thy cheeks? This enforced marriage towards?
It helps, good aunt, amongst other griefs. But those I'll keep locked up in modest silence, for their sorrows would shame the tongue more than they grieve the thought.
Indeed, the word is simple.
Simple? That were well. Why, one might make good shift with such a husband. But he's a fool entailed. He halts downright in't.
And knowing this, I hope 'tis at your choice to take or refuse, niece.
You see, it is not. I loathe him more than beauty can hate death or age, her spiteful neighbour.
Let it appear, then.
How can I, being born with that obedience that must submit unto a father's will? If he command, I must of force consent.
Alas, poor soul, be not offended, prithee. If I set by the name of niece a while, and bring in pity in a stranger fashion, it lies here in this breast would cross this match.
How cross it?
Aye, and give thee more liberty than thou hast reason yet to apprehend.
Sweetheart, in goodness, keep not hid from me what may befriend my life.
Yes, yes, I must. When I return to reputation and think upon the solemn vow I made to your dead mother, my most loving sister, as long as I have her memory twixt mine eyelids, look for no pity now.
Kind, sweet, dear aunt.
No, 'twas a secret I have took special care of, delivered by your mother on her deathbed. That's 9 years now, and I'll not part from it yet, though ne'er was a fitter time nor greater cause for it.
You desire the praises of a virgin.
Good sorrow, I would do thee any kindness, not wronging secrecy or reputation.
Neither of which, as I have hope of fruitfulness, shall receive wrong from me.
Nay, 'twould be your own wrong, as much as any, should it come to that once.
I need no better means to work persuasion, then.
Let it suffice. You may refuse this fool, or you may take him as you see occasion for your advantage. The best wits will do it. You've liberty enough in your own will. You cannot be enforced. There grows the flower. If you could pick it out, makes whole life sweet to you. That which you call your father's commands, nothing. Then your obedience must be as little. If you can make shift here to taste your happiness, or pick out aught that likes you, much good do you. You see your cheer. I'll make you no set dinner.
Trust me, I may starve for all the good I can find yet in this. Sweet aunt, deal plainlier.
Say I should trust you now upon an oath, and give you in a secret that would start you. How am I sure of you in faith and silence?
Equal assurance may I find in mercy, as you for that in me.
It shall suffice. Then know, however custom is made good, for reputation's sake, The names of niece and aunt twixt you and I, we're nothing less.
How's that?
I told you I should start your blood. You are no more allied to any of us, save what the courtesy of opinion casts upon your mother's memory and your name, than the merest stranger is, or one begot at Naples when the husband lies at Rome. There's so much odds betwixt us. Since your knowledge wish more instruction, and I have your oath in pledge for silence, it makes me talk the freelier. Did never report of that famed Spaniard, Marquis of Coria, since your time was ripe for understanding, fill your ear with wonder?
Yes, what of him? I've heard his deeds of honour often related when we lived in Naples.
You heard the praises of your father, then?
My father?
That was he. But all the business so carefully and so discreetly carried that fame received no spot by it, not a blemish. Your mother was so wary to her end, none knew it but her conscience and her friend, till penitent confession made it mine, and now my pity yours. It had been long else, and I hope care and love alike in you made good by oath will see it take no wrong now. How weak his commands now, whom you call father! How vain all his enforcements, your obedience! And what a largeness in your will and liberty to take or to reject or to do both! For fools will serve to father wise men's children. All this you've time to think on. Oh, my wench, nothing overthrows our sex but indiscretion. We might do well else of a brittle people as any under the great canopy. I pray, forget not but to call me aunt still. Take heed of that, it may be marked in time else. But keep your thoughts to yourself from all the world, kindred and dearest friend. Nay, I entreat you from him that all this while you have called uncle. And though you love him dearly, as I know his deserts claim as much even from a stranger, yet let not him know this. I prithee do not. As ever thou hast hope of second pity, if thou shouldst stand in need on it, do not do it.
Believe my oath. I will not.
Why, well said. Who shows more craft to undo a maidenhead? I'll resign my part to her. She's thine own. Go.
Very good. Well, this scene is very interesting because she's thinking on her feet.
Mm.
I mean, she's not thought about any of this before. So this is the humour of the scene. And also, she's got to think very quickly this story. So she's making it up. And that's what makes it very much in the present. So she's thinking it up as she goes. But she doesn't show that she's thinking it up, but she is thinking it up. So to give herself time to think it up, we have to go through it again. So we'll go from when Isabella comes in, and we'll just stop and start a little bit on the way.
Mm-hmm.
Niece, your love's welcome.
Niece, your love's welcome. Alas, what draws that paleness to thy cheeks? This enforced marriage towards?
It helps, good aunt. Amongst other griefs, but those I'll keep locked up in modest silence, for their sorrows would shame the tongue more than they grieve the thought.
Indeed, the ward is simple.
Simple? That were well. Why, one might make good shift with such a husband, but he's a fool entailed. He halts downright in't.
And knowing this, I hope 'tis at your choice to take or refuse, niece.
You see, it is not. I loathe him more than beauty can hate death or age, her spiteful neighbour.
Let it appear, then.
How can I, being born with that obedience that must submit unto a father's will? If he command, I must of force consent.
Alas, poor soul. Be not offended, prithee, if I set by the name of niece a while and bring in pity in a stranger fashion. It lies here in this breast would cross this match.
Lovely. Now we'll just look at that first little section first, because I think what happens there is that there's a sort of, you know the whole story. So there's a sort of nonchalance about the beginning here,
okay,
where I think you sort of vaguely ask her about, you know, alas, I'm very, very concerned. What brings this, you know, paleness to your cheek? And, you know, you're a complete innocent in this situation. And then she's, you, because you're so open and, oh, you poor thing, she then tells you that. Mm. And you say, well, you know, you hadn't thought about him before, but you say, no, I suppose he's a bit simple, you know, indeed the ward is simple, you know, he's a very simple sort, which probably isn't something that you like. And then he says, no, you see, he is. And then she opens up, you see, so that then, and then you say, and knowing this, I hope it is your choice to take or to refuse him. You know, it's a terribly, you know, you're not terribly engaged. You're much older, so you can be sort of, I hope it's your choice. You know, you have the choice to do that. So then makes her talk even more. No, you see, I don't have the choice. So then she starts to say, I have to do what my father says because of, and then says, she says, well, let it appear then. You know, terribly reasonable.
Yes.
Don't sort of take her energy. Take it so that it's, you know, you're drawing her out. Okay. You're drawing her out. And what you're drawing is like that spine. You're sitting there and being terribly reasonable and sort of listening. And she does all the emotion because she doesn't want to do it. And she's got to sort of convince you. So then you come to the killer punch in the next thing, saying, alas, poor soul, be not offended, prithee. You sort of give it a bit of thought. Mm-hmm. Be not offended if I set the name of niece, set by the name of niece a while. She's thinking all the time here. Mm-hmm. And bring in pity in a strange fashion. Lies here in my breast. I could do something about this. Mm-hmm. And then she says, Hagrid, I give thee more liberty. So she says, gives her more hope.
Yes.
You see, mm-hmm. more hope. So let's just do that little bit first of all and see how we get on with that bit first.
From Nice.
Nice, so nice, so pleased to see you.
Oh, Nice, your love's welcome. Alas, what draws that paleness to thy cheeks? This enforced marriage towards?
It helps, good aunt, amongst other griefs. But those I'll keep locked up in modest silence, for they are sorrows would shame the tongue more than they grieve the thought.
Indeed, the ward is simple.
Yes, you see, because you know that he's made a pass at her, and she's got these other thoughts. But you put it down to the ward. Indeed, the ward is simple. You know, and she says, well, no, you know, yes, he is. So, see, simple. Simple, that's an understatement. Yeah. You know, that's what she's saying. So I think she's saying, you know, he's a bit dull. Dull? He's boring as hell, is what she's saying. So we'll just do that little first bit again.
Niece, your love's welcome. Alas, what draws that paleness to thy cheeks? This enforced marriage towards?
It helps, good aunt, amongst other griefs. But those I'll keep locked up in modest silence, for their sorrows would shame the tongue more than they grieve the thought.
Indeed, the ward is simple.
Simple? That's, you see, it's lovely, because suddenly we get a picture of this ward, and then, simple, you know. Sorry to interrupt. Indeed, the ward is simple. That was beautifully read.
From there?
Indeed, the ward is simple.
Indeed, the ward is simple.
Simple? That were well. Why, one might make good shift with such a husband. But he's a fool entailed. He halts downright in it.
And knowing this, I hope, is that your choice to take or refuse, niece?
You see, it is not. I loathe him more than beauty can hate death or age, her spiteful neighbour.
You see, I think that that's lovely, but you could start off there, because it's a half line. You can say, because, and knowing this is not, 'tis your choice, which was beautifully read. You see, it is not. Carry it on. Okay. Don't take it back to where it was, because you're telling the story ahead. Always go ahead. Mm-hmm. You see, it is not. I mean, that is the thing. You see, it is not. I loathe him more than, you see, and then you put your cards on the table because you think you're going to be quite happy here with him. Okay?
And knowing this?
Yeah.
And knowing this, I hope, is that your choice to take or refuse, niece?
You see, it is not. I loathe him more than beauty can hate death or age, her spiteful neighbour.
Oh, let it appear then.
How can I?
Exactly, you see, suddenly then there's the humour. You see, you're saying, well, then let it appear, tell them. And I can't tell him because I've got to marry him. So, you see, then it's sort of, you see.
Let it appear?
Yes.
Let it appear then.
Well, how can I, being born with that obedience that must submit unto a father's will?
A father's will.
A father's will.
Yes, because it's the will of the father. Is what I'm saying. It's not the father's will. Mm-hmm. It's the father's will. I mean, it's his will. I'm having to do his bidding. So if the word will is given a bit more, it's my father's will. I mean, that is what he wants me to do. Okay. So if you bring the word back, it doesn't have the resonance that it should have. Mm-hmm. Don't worry, I'm not shouting.
How can I, being born with that obedience that must submit unto a father's will? If he command, I must of force consent.
Alas, poor soul, be not offended, prithee. If I set by the name of niece a while, and bring in pity in a stranger fashion, it lies here in this breast would cross this match.
Yes, and I think you might walk away with her. Well, walk away if you were doing that. It lies here in this... Oh, I think we could cross this match. And...
She said what?
You see, suddenly it's very interesting. Oh, I think I might be able to do something about that. Well, what? You see, so that's what it... So you don't have to have eye contact with her all the time. It's just, I wonder whether I could... There's something I might know about this. Oh. And it's all a bit slow, and you say, go!
You see, it's teething.
Yeah. Okay. That's exactly it. Also, it gives you time to think.
Yes. Alas, poor soul, be not offended, prithee, if I set by the name of niece a while, and bring in pity in a stranger fashion. Lies here in this breast would cross this match.
How cross it, aunt?
Ay, and give thee more liberty than thou hast reason yet to apprehend.
Sweet aunt, in goodness keep not hid from me what may befriend my life.
Yes, I must. When I return to reputation and think upon the solemn vow I made to your dead mother, my most loving sister.
Yes, that's it. Yes, I must. Yes, I must. Oh, I must. Because when I remember my darling sister, you know, she's having a real fun here. So when I return to reputation, that is the word there. When I return to reputation and think upon the solemn vow I made to your dead mother, my dear sister. Reputation, vow. Those words are what, because we're going to talk about that in a minute.
Yes.
So we don't want to go back because we won't get to it. Lovely. So we'll go on. We'll just go, your dead mother, my most loving sister.
Your dead mother, my most loving sister. As long as I have her memory twixt my eyelids, look for no pity now.
Kind, sweet, dear aunt.
No, 'twas a secret I have took special care of, delivered by your mother on her deathbed. That's 9 years now, and I'll not part from it yet.
You see, the thing is, now you've got her exactly where you want her, because she's forcing it out of you. You're this person who has this secret, which you shouldn't really tell. And she's saying, please tell me. And she's saying, she's walking away, perhaps she's walking away, and she's following her, saying, please, please, and please. She's saying, well, no, I can't, you know, I really can't. So you feel, so that she will feel, that she has forced it out of you.
Yes.
Do you see?
Okay, yeah.
That's what you've done. So that's where the energy is. No, it was a secret. No.
No.
It was a secret. I can't tell anyone. It was a secret. You know. And I had to get special care of it, delivered by your mum. 9 years I've carried this around with me. This truth. You see, it's all that. So it's good fun.
Theatre of it.
Yes.
From 'Twas a Secret?
Yeah.
No, 'twas a secret I have took special care of, delivered by your mother on her deathbed. That's 9 years now, and I'll not part from it yet. Though never was a fitter time and greater cause for it.
You see, just to add to it, mind you, this is a good time to tell you about that, but I can't. You see, so then she, poor Isabel, says,
as you desire the praises of a virgin.
Good, you see, it's more, as you desire the praises of a virgin. She's please tell me, because it might just be the way out. Mm-hmm. You see, it's all so, you know, she's got you. So we won't go back on it, but that's the sort of feeling.
Good sorrow, I would do thee any kindness, not wronging secrecy or reputation.
No, yes, but those two words, not wronging secrecy or reputation. You see, we won't go back, but that's just the feeling of it.
Neither of which, as I have hope of fruitfulness, shall receive wrong from me.
Nay, 'twould be your own wrong, as much as any, should it come to that once.
I need no better means to work persuasion then.
Let it suffice. You may refuse this fool, or you may take him.
Now, this is what you start. Let it suffice. Those two little dots. Mm-hmm. You may refuse this fool, or you may take him. Because you know you're going to tell her something.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you're saying you do have a choice. So, that's mm-hmm. what you're saying. So, don't run. Let it suffice. Now you go, let it suffice. Look, I'm going to tell you.
Mm-hmm.
This is what I've got to tell you. And then you tell him.
Mm-hmm. Much like this is the comfort.
Yes, that's right.
Let it suffice. You may refuse this fool, or you may take him, as you see occasion for your advantage. The best wits will do it. You've liberty enough in your own will. You cannot be enforced.
You cannot be enforced, you see. I mean, you're doing it, but I'm just saying, those are the words, the strong words.
There grows the flower.
There grows the flower, if you could pick it out, that makes whole life sweet to you. Just go from there grows the flower.
Yep.
It's lovely.
There grows the flower. If you could pick it out, makes whole life sweet to you. That which you call your father's commands, nothing. Then your obedience must be as little. If you can make shift here to taste your happiness, or pick out aught that likes you, much good do you. You see your cheer. I'll make you no set dinner.
And trust me, I may starve for all the good I can find yet in this. Sweet aunt, deal plainlier.
Say I should trust you now upon an oath, and give you in a secret that would start you. How am I sure of you in faith and silence?
Equal assurance may I find in mercy as you for that in me.
It shall suffice.
It's not, it shall suffice. It shall suffice. What I'm going to tell you now is so secret. This is such a secret.
Hmm.
How am I to know that you're not going to go around blabbing it all to everybody else? Because this is such a secret.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, well, you know, I promise I won't tell anyone. It shall suffice.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm going to tell you. This is the piece of information I'm going to tell you. So it's very serious. If you tell anybody this, we're up shit creek without a paddle.
Mm. The stakes are high.
Exactly.
It shall suffice. Then know, however custom has made good for reputation's sake, the names of niece and aunt twixt you and I, we're nothing less.
How's that?
I told you I should start your blood. You are no more allied to any of us, save what the courtesy of opinion casts upon your mother's memory and your name, than the merest stranger is, or one begot at Naples when the husband lies at Rome.
Well, that's the thing, because what you're saying is that the husband was away, and her mother got into bed with someone at home while he was away.
Mm.
So that is the little play on words. So it is, or one begot at Naples when the husband lies in Rome. For goodness sake. So there's all that going on.
Yes.
Do you see? So there's a certain amount of sort of, you know, it's all terribly naughty, this. So, you know, she's, yes, you're playing it. She falls for it completely.
Where from?
Then the merest stranger is.
Then the merest stranger is, or one begot at Naples, when the husband lies in Rome. There's so much odds betwixt us. Since your knowledge wished more instruction, and I have your oath in pledge for silence, it makes me talk the freelier. Did never report of that famed Spaniard.
Now, this is the news.
New. Mm.
Did ever report of that famed Spaniard? Do you see?
Yeah.
It's sort of this man is suddenly plucking it out of the ground. I mean, you're plucking it out of the air. This is all making it up as you go along.
Yeah.
So, this man, and she says, well, yes, I did hear about him. Well, he's your father.
Yeah.
I mean, goodness me. So, there we go.
Mm.
So just through, if you sort of just try to just drop it in.
Mm.
Just drop the name.
Okay.
And he does happen to be a marquis.
Yeah.
The Marquis of Marquis of Coria, yeah.
Did never report of that famed Spaniard, Marquis of Coria, Since your time was ripe for understanding, fill your ear with wonder.
Yes, what of him? I have heard his deeds of honour often related when we lived in Naples.
You had the praises of your father then.
I think that's the coup de grace.
Okay.
You have the praises of your father then.
My father?
Yes, see.
Yeah, yes.
That was he. But all the, and then you go on, that was he, but all the business discreetly. You see, that's what you've delivered. Yes. You've delivered that she has got nothing to do with you. You're not an aunt. She had a completely different father, so she can have a relationship with her uncle. So that was your, so always give it to the weight, because that's the end of the story.
Yes.
That was your father then. Mm-hmm. Father, you see, and then we can tell the story further. Mm-hmm. But if we don't deliver that, then people say, what was that? What was that? Did I miss a bit? That's, you see?
Yes.
So you must deliver the key for telling a story. Just carry on. That was he.
That was he. But all the business so carefully and so discreetly carried that fame received no spot by it, not a blemish. Your mother was so wary to her end, none knew it but her conscience and her friend, till penitent confession made it mine, and now my pity yours. It had been long else, and I hope care and love alike in you, made good by oath, will see it take no wrong now. How weak is Gamard now?
Now then, you see,
then
yes.
You again.
How weak is Gamard now? You see, suddenly. You see the benefit of this? Mm. How weak is Gamard now? You know, he doesn't hold a, he's got, he can't tell you anything. So.
How weak his commands now, whom you call father. How vain all his enforcements, your obedience. And what a largeness in your will and liberty to take, or to reject, or to do both. For fools will serve to father wise men's children. All this you've time to think on. Oh, my wench, nothing o'erthrows our sex but indiscretion. We might do well else of a brittle people as any under the great canopy. I pray forget not, but to call me aunt still. Take heed of that, it may be marked in time else. But keep your thoughts to yourself from all the world, kindred or dearest friend. Nay, I entreat you from him that all this while you have called uncle, and though you love him dearly, as I know his deserts claim as much even from a stranger, yet let not him know this. I prithee do not. As
I
ever,
prithee do not.
I prithee do not. As ever thou hast hope of second pity, if thou shouldst stand in need on it, do not do it.
Believe my oath, I will not.
Why, well said. Who shows more craft undo a maidenhead? I'll resign my part to her. She's thine own, go.
Yes. You see? You've won him. And this is what you've set up.
Mm.
It's brilliant. It's brilliant writing.
Mm.
Isn't it? It's just wonderful. It's the most brilliant writing. Because she just... You don't know where it's going. And then suddenly it arrives. And she says, and the last line is so simple. She's thine own girl.
Yeah. All yours.
You've got her. All yours. On to you. So shall we go on?
Yes. Alas, fair flattery cannot cure my sorrows.
Have I passed so much time in ignorance, and never had the means to know myself till this blessed hour? Thanks to her virtuous pity that brought it now to light. Would I had known it but one day sooner, he had then received in favours what, poor gentleman, he took in bitter words, a slight and harsh reward for one of his deserts.
Oh, there seems to be now more anger and distraction in her looks. I'm gone. I'll not endure a second storm. The memory of the first is not... past yet.
Are you returned? You comfort of my life in this man's presence. I will keep you fast now and soon apart eternally from the world with my good joys in you. Prithee, forgive me. I did but chide and jest. The best loves use it sometimes. It sets an edge upon affection. When we invite our best friends to a feast, 'tis not all sweet meats that we set before them. There's somewhat sharp and salt, both to whet the appetite and make them taste their wine well. So methinks, after a friendly, sharp, and savoury chiding, a kiss tastes wondrous well and full of the grape. How thinkst thou? does not?
Tis so excellent. I not know not how to praise it, what to say to it.
This marriage shall go forward.
With the ward? Are you in earnest?
'Twould be ill for us else.
For us? How means she that?
Truth, I begin to be so well, methinks, within this hour. For all this match able to kill one's heart, nothing can pull me down now. Should my father provide a worse fool yet, which I should think were a hard thing to compass, I'd have him either. The worse, the better, none can come amiss now if he want wit enough. So discretion, love me, desert and judgment, I have content sufficient. She that comes once to be a housekeeper must not look every day to farewell, sir, like a young waiting gentlewoman in service, for she feeds commonly, as her lady does. No good bit passes her, but she gets taste on't. But when she comes to keep house for herself, she's glad of some choice cates then once a week, or twice at most, and glad if she can get them. So must affection learn to fare with thankfulness. Pray, make your love no stranger, sir. That's all. Though you be one yourself and know not aunt, and I have sworn you must not.
This is beyond me.
That's wonderful. He goes out and there's a very long silence. This is beyond me. One minute everyone's hitting him, the next minute suddenly she's giving him a kiss and saying, I'm going to marry the warden, it'll be much better. I mean, it's amazing.
Yeah.
That this has fallen into your lap. I mean, it's wonderful. Just that's all in This Is Beyond Me. Do carry on.
Never came joy so unexpectedly to meet desires in man. How came she thus? What has she done to her? Can any tell? It is beyond sorcery, this, drugs or love powders, some art that has no name, sure. Strange to me of all the wonders I e'er met with all throughout my 10 years' travels. But I am thankful for it. This marriage now must of necessity forward. It is the only veil wit can devise to keep our acts hid from sin-piercing eyes.
That's lovely. Now, we'll just go back over that. Because there's the aside and the also she's a great flirt in Isabella, I think the first bit, the first aside, is quite anguished, because it's, I don't know about this, but you know, because he says, well, she looks pretty angry. I think I'm not going to stay. I'm not going to get another, you know, slap across the face. So it's quite an anguished sort of knowledge, and you're trying to sort of digest everything you've been told by Livia. So it sort of has a sort of feeling of anguish about it. And then you look at him, and he's sort of there. And you're saying, are you returned the comfort of my life? I mean, you know, you're so pleased. It's wonderful. And then there's a moment when you say, prithee forgive me if I, and it's much more sort of in control. So you're, what I'm saying is, your private thoughts that she voices are more, and then when you're with him, you're more in control, because you don't want to show him that. I mean, you want to, then you give him a kiss and so on, but you're more in control. You're sort of, you absolutely know what you've got to do. You're going to marry the ward. You're going to be having him at the same time. But the cover will be the ward. And you can have children. And goodness me, who knows if they're not going to be his children. I mean, the ward will think it's his children, but they'll probably be his children. So, who, you know, you can have this wonderful relationship and no one will know anything. So, you know, life is rosy. But the anguish inside at the beginning is important, because then you have the change when you're with him, which is much more in command. And also flirty and all the rest of it. So, and this marriage will go ahead. She's absolutely got it. Oh yes, I'll marry him. It'll be much better for us, all the rest of it. So she's got it sorted. See, there are no really good characters in this play. So let's do that.
Have I passed so much time in ignorance and never had the means to know myself till this blessed hour? Thanks to her virtuous pity that brought it now to light. Would I had known it but one day sooner. He had then received in favours what, poor gentleman, he took in bitter words a slight and harsh reward for one of his deserts.
Well, there seems to be now more anger and distraction in her looks. I'm gone. I'll not endure a second storm. The memory of the first is not past yet.
You returned. You comforts of my life in this man's presence. I will keep you fast now, and soon apart eternally from the world, than my good joys in you. Prithee, forgive me. I did but chide and jest. The best loves use it sometimes. It sets an edge upon affection. When we invite our best friends to a feast, 'tis not all sweet meats that we set before them. There's somewhat sharp and salt, both to whet the appetite and make them taste their wine well. So, methinks, after a friendly, sharp and savoury chiding, a kiss tastes wondrous well and full of the grape. How thinkst thou? Dost not?
'Tis so excellent. I know not how to praise it. What to say to it?
This marriage shall go forward.
With the ward? Are you in earnest?
'Twould be ill for us else.
For us? How means she that?
Troth, I begin to be so well, methinks, within this hour. For all this match, able to kill one's heart, nothing can pull me down now. Should my father provide a worse fool yet, which I should think were a hard thing to compass, I'd have him either. The worse, the better, none can come amiss now if he want wit enough. So discretion, love me. Desert and judgment, I have content sufficient. She that comes wants to be a housekeeper must not look every day to fare well, sir, like a young waiting gentlewoman in service, for she feeds commonly as her lady does. No good bit passes her, but she gets taste on't. But when she comes to keep house for herself, she's glad of some choice cates once a week, or twice at most, and glad if she can get them. So must affection learn to fare with thankfulness. Pray, make your love no stranger, sir. That's all. Though you be one yourself and know not aunt, and I have sworn you must not.
There, you see. I think that the very last line, pray make your love no stranger, sir, that's all, that's the most important line. Mm-hmm. And then we don't forget, and neither do we, though you be one yourself and know not aunt, and I have sworn you must. So you must not. And so, you know, he's no relation. Mm-hmm. But that line is terribly important. Pray, make your love no stranger, sir. And if I was staging it, would be quite interesting if when you were doing the anguishing moments, you were still. And then when you weren't, you were perhaps walking around him.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think she's a bit of a flirt, and she's enjoying this. And also, she's a young woman, and she loves him. And she can flirt a lot there. Right, we'll go on to this last bit here. Then I think we'll go through, we'll just read the whole thing, shall we, after mm-hmm. that? Would that be a good idea?
Yeah.
Just, I don't expect anything, so don't worry. Any of you, all we do is just read it through and see how, because all these things, like anything, you have to digest things. I always think that rehearsing plays, it's like laying down wine. You have a few ideas and then they sort of percolate through, and then you leave them for a day or so, and then they sort of lie there and they sort of mature a bit, and then the ideas become internalise them, mm-hmm. and then you can bring them out again. But you can't always do that immediately. Mm. Just one's mind needs time to do all these things. So I never expect anything immediately. It's just things to think about,
yes.
And also to tell the story so well. So let's just finish this last bit, and then we'll go on. We'll start at the beginning.
This is beyond me. Never came joy so unexpectedly to meet desires in man. How came she thus? What has she done to her? Can any tell? 'Tis beyond sorcery, this, drugs or love powders. Some art that has no name, sure. Strange to me of all the wonders I e'er met with all throughout my 10 years' travels. But I am thankful for it. This marriage now must of necessity forward. It is the only veil wit can devise to keep our axe hid from sin-piercing eyes.
Whenever you finish a line, especially with an exit line, you take it up at the end.
Yeah.
Just, that's purely. To keep our axe hid from sin-piercing eyes. You know, always deliver it.
Yeah.
Because that sin-piercing eyes is what you don't want, you've got to cover your... Because this is not allowed, this relationship. So all the things, and I think the beginning of that, you can take all the time in the... I think also that, but I am thankful for it. You know, whenever you say anything, don't pull back on it.
Mm.
It's like, it's not speaking loudly, it's just giving the words their weight and not being shy of them. And that is quite difficult to learn, but you have to give the words their weight. And it's all to do with confidence and how we are. And it's being also on a stage that this is somebody's words they've written. It's nothing to do with you, except you're delivering them. But this is somebody who has written these words. So give them the weight. Give Middleton his, you know, what he's written. Just allow him to be heard.
Yeah.
And don't be shy about it. And if it's wrong, it's wrong. And you can correct it. But give it its weight.
Yeah.
Just never pull back and be shy about it. Because who cares? It's either right or wrong. It doesn't really matter. You know.
Yeah.
So lovely. Well, I'm very pleased. I think you really pick it up so quick. It's marvellous. So I don't think we'll move it today. If you're quite happy sitting here, because I think we've done so well how we are that moving it suddenly brings in a whole lot of other things.
Mm-hmm.
So shall we just try and read it through and see how we get on?
Yes.
Okay. So perhaps if I say, the stage is absolutely bare, the door opens, the door shuts, and...
A strange affection, brother. When I think on it, I wonder how thou camest by it.
Even as easily as a man comes by destruction, which oft times he wears in his own bosom.
Is the world so populous in women, and creation so prodigal in beauty, and so various? Yet does love turn thy point to thy own blood? 'Tis somewhat too unkindly. Must thy eye dwell evilly on the fairness of thy kindred, and seek not where it should? It is confined now in a narrower prison than was made for it. It is allowed a stranger. And where bounty is made the great man's honour, 'tis ill husbandry to spare, and servants shall have small thanks for it. So he heaven's bounty seems to scorn and mock, that spares free means and spends of his own stock.
Never was man's misery so soon summed up, counting how true...
Nay, I love you so, that I shall venture much to keep a change from you, so fearful as this grief will bring upon you. Faith, it even kills me when I see you faint under a reprehension, and I'll leave it, though I know nothing can be better for you. Prithee, sweet brother, let not passion waste the goodness of thy time and of thy fortune. Thou keeps the treasure of that life I love as dearly as mine own, and if you think my former words too bitter, which were ministered by truth and zeal, 'tis but a hazarding of grace and virtue, and I can bring forth as pleasant fruits as sensuality wishes in all her teeming longings. This I can do.
Oh, nothing that can make my wishes perfect.
I would that love of yours were pawned to it, brother, and as soon lost that way as I could win. Sir, I could give a shrewder lift to chastity as any she that wears a tongue in Florence. She need be a good horsewoman and sit fast, whom minds from argument could not fling at last. Prithee, take courage, man. Though I should counsel another to despair, yet I am pitiful to thy afflictions and will venture hard. I will not name for what 'tis not handsome. Find you the proof and praise me.
Then I fear me I shall not praise you in haste.
This is the comfort. You are not the first, brother, has attempted things more forbidden than this seems to be. I'll minister all cordials to you now, because I'd cheer you up, sir.
I'm past hope.
Love, thou shalt see me do a strange cure then, as e'er was wrought on a disease so mortal and near akin to shame. When shall you see her?
Never in comfort more.
You're so impatient too.
Will you believe? death, she's forsworn my company and sealed it with a blush.
So I perceive all lies upon my hands, then. Well, the more glory when the work's finished. How now, sir, the news?
Madam, your niece, the virtuous Isabella, is lighted to see you.
That's great fortune. Sir, your stars bless. You simple, lead her in.
What's this to me?
Your absence, gentle brother. I must bestir my wits for you.
Aye, to great purpose.
Beshrew you, would I loved you not so well. I'll go to bed and leave this deed undone. I am the fondest where I once affect, the carefulest of their healths and of their ease, forsooth, that I look still but slenderly to mine own. I take a cause to pity him so much now that I have none left for modesty in myself. This 'tis to grow so liberal. You few sisters that love their brother's ease above their own honesties. But if you question my affections, that will be found my fault. Niece, your love's welcome. Alas, what draws that paleness to thy cheeks? This enforced marriage towards?
It helps, good aunt, amongst other griefs. But those I'll keep locked up in modest silence, for their sorrows would shame the tongue more than they grieve the thought.
Indeed, the ward is simple.
Simple? That were well. Why, one might make good shift with such a husband. But he's a fool entailed. He halts downright in't.
And knowing this, I hope, is that your choice to take or refuse?
You see, it is not. I loathe him more than beauty can hate death or age, her spiteful neighbour.
Let it appear, then.
How can I? Being born with that obedience that must submit unto a father's will. If he command, I must of force consent.
Alas, poor soul. Be not offended, prithee, if I set by the name of niece a while and bring in pity in a stranger fashion. It lies here in this breast, would cross this match.
How cross it, aunt?
Aye, and give thee more liberty than thou hast reason yet to apprehend.
Sweet aunt, in goodness, keep not hid from me what may befriend my life.
Yes, yes, I must, when I return to reputation, and think upon the solemn vow I made to your dead mother, my most loving sister. As long as I have her memory twixt my eyelids, look for no pity now.
Kind, sweet, dear
no,
aunt.
No, 'twas a secret I have took special care of. Delivered by your mother on her deathbed. That's 9 years now, and I'll not part from it yet. Though never was a fitter time or greater cause for it.
As you desire the praises of a virgin.
Good sorrow, I would do thee any kindness, not wronging secrecy or reputation.
Neither of which, as I have hope of fruitfulness, shall receive wrong from me.
Nay, 'twould be your own wrong, as much as any, should it come to that once.
I need no better means to work persuasion, then.
Let it suffice. You may refuse this fool, or you may take him, as you see occasion for your advantage. The best wits will do it. You've liberty enough in your own will. You cannot be enforced. There grows the flower. If you could pick it out, makes whole life sweet to you. That which you call your father's commands, nothing. Then your obedience must be as little. If you can make shift here to taste your happiness, or pick out all that likes you, much good do you. You see your share. I'll make you no set dinner.
Trust me, I may starve for all the good I can find yet in this. Sweet aunt, deal plainlier.
Say I should trust you now upon an oath, and give you in a secret that would start you. How am I sure of you in faith and silence?
Equal assurance may I find in mercy as you for that in me.
It shall suffice. Then know, however custom has made good for reputation's sake, the names of niece and aunt twixt you and I were nothing less.
How's that?
I told you I should start your blood. You are no more allied to any of us, save what the courtesy of opinion casts upon your mother's memory and your name, than the merest stranger is, or one begot at Naples while the husband lies at Rome. There's so much odds betwixt us. Since your knowledge wished more instruction, and I have oath in pledge for silence, it makes me talk the freelier. Did never report of that famed Spaniard Marquis of Coria, since your time was ripe for understanding, fill your ear with wonder?
Yes, what of him? I've heard his deeds of honour often related when we lived in Naples.
You heard the praises of your father, then?
My father?
That was he. But all the business so carefully and so discreetly carried that fame received no spot by it, not a blemish. Your mother was so wary to her end, none knew it but her conscience and her friend, till penitent confession made it mine, and now my pity yours. It had been long else, and I hope care and love alike in you, made good by oath, will see it take no wrong now. How weak his commands now, whom you call father. How vain all his enforcements, your obedience. And what a largeness in your will and liberty to take or to reject or to do both. For fools will serve to father wise men's children. All this you've time to think on. Oh, my wench, nothing offers our sex but indiscretion. We might do well else of a brittle people as any under the great canopy. I pray forget not but to call me aunt still. Take heed of that, it may be marked in time else. But keep your thoughts to yourself from all the world, kindred or dearest friend. Nay, I entreat you from him that all this while you have called uncle, and though you love him dearly, as I know his deserts claim as much even from a stranger, yet let not him know this. I prithee do not. As ever thou hast hope of second pity, if thou shouldst stand in need on it, do not do it.
Believe my oath. I will not.
Why, well said. Who shows more craft to undo a maidenhead? I'll resign my part to her. She's thine own. Go.
Alas, fair flattery cannot cure my sorrows.
Have I passed so much time in ignorance and never had the means to know myself till this blessed hour? Thanks to her virtuous pity that brought it now to light. Would I had known it but one day sooner, he had then received in favours what, poor gentleman, he took in bitter words, a slight and harsh reward for one of his deserts.
Oh, there seems to be now more anger and distraction in her looks. I'm gone. I'll not endure a second storm. The memory of the first has not passed yet.
Are you returned? You comforts of my life in this man's presence. I will keep you fast now, and sooner part eternally from the world than my good joys in you. Prithee, forgive me. I did but chide and jest. The best loves use it sometimes. It sets an edge upon affection. When we invite our best friends to a feast, 'tis not all sweet meats that we set before them. There's somewhat sharp and salt, both to whet the appetite and make them taste their wine well. So methinks, after a friendly, sharp and savoury chiding, a kiss tastes wondrous well and full of the grape. How thinkst thou, dost not?
Tis so excellent. I know not how to praise it. What to say to it?
This marriage shall go forward.
With the ward? Are you in earnest?
'Twould be ill for us else.
For us? How means she that?
Troth, I begin to be so well, methinks, within this hour. For all this match able to kill one's heart, nothing can pull me down now. Should my father provide a worse fool yet, which I should think were a hard thing to compass, I'd have him either. The worse, the better. None can come amiss now if he want wit enough. So discretion, love me, desert and judgment. I have content sufficient. She that comes once to be a housekeeper must not look every day to farewell, sir, like a young waiting gentlewoman in service, for she feeds commonly, as her lady does. No good bit passes her, but she gets a taste on't. But when she comes to keep house for herself, she's glad of some choice cates, then once a week, or twice at most, and glad if she can get them. So must affection learn to fare with thankfulness. Pray, make your love no stranger, sir. That's all. Though you be one yourself and know not aunt, and I have sworn you must not.
Oh, this is beyond me. Never came joys so unexpectedly to meet desires in man. How came she thus? What has she done to her? Can any tell? 'Tis beyond sorcery, this, drugs or love powders. Some art that has no name, sure. Strange to me of all the wonders I e'er met withal throughout my 10 years' travels. But I am thankful for it. This marriage now must of necessity forward. It is the only veil wit can devise to keep our acts hid from sin-piercing eyes.
Bravo. I thought that was very good and exciting. I really did. And given a bit more and, you know, the moves and everything, that would really come alive. Did you feel it yourselves? It's exciting, isn't it? It's exciting writing, I think. I think it's really, it's hard, but it's very exciting and so full of colour.
Would you get past all the metaphors?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Well, thank you.